And I thank you for your presence here this evening for what I think will be the an annual gathering in honor of innovation and to hear the work product of those who have been selected as finalists. One of my favorite poets is Carl Sandburg, and he once said that nothing happens unless first a dream. And that is certainly true in the history of Pepperdine University. But for the dream articulated by George Pepperdine, we would not be here today. That's also true of your lives as you anticipate your future, your careers, the things that excite you, the things that you're working toward. Even now, nothing happens unless first a dream. And I hope that Pepperdine for you is a step along the way to the fulfillment of your dreams. For those of us who created this idea of gathering around innovation and encouraging innovation within the Pepperdine community about a year ago, tonight feels really good. We knew that we wanted an event like this. We had no idea how many would show up. We had no idea how many projects would be submitted, but we fortunately and gratefully received 158 applications, submissions for our consideration for waves of innovation. I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for a wonderful committee who will be introduced to you later this evening who winnowed the 158 down to a very special 8 applications. And I'm grateful to each of you for your presence this evening as you witness their witty talks and also the celebration of those who are selected as victors. They're all victors, but at the end of the evening, the few who are selected for funding. I hope you're excited about that. I'm certainly excited about that. This dream, as it's being fulfilled this evening, would not be possible but for the very important and strategic work of Dr. Lee Katz, who, when he heard about the project, volunteered quickly to help us with it, and indeed we tapped him to lead it. He has kept it moving all along. He helped us select just the right committee, I think. And tonight, and the excitement that surrounds tonight, would not be possible without his leadership and his belief in this important and new Pepperdine tradition. So without further delay, as we move into the talks, and indeed the celebration we anticipate at the end, I give you the chairman of the Waves of Innovation Committee and the leader of this project, Dr. Lee Katz.
Well, this is going to be fun, and let me add my welcome to that of President Benton's. We are glad you are here and able to join us for this first ever Waves of Innovation event. Before we get started, this is an academic enterprise, right, so we're going to start with a quiz. And so I'm going to put some characteristics up here, and you folks think long and hard and deeply about who I might be describing. We're talking about a university founder that took a leap of faith and started a Christian college in 1937. University Business School is one of the first on the West Coast to offer the executive MBA degree. First law school to establish an institute program in alternate dispute resolution. What school was that? What university has 5 campuses in Southern California, 6 international campuses, offering a plethora of learning and opportunities? And what university had the first school of education psychology to have the school entrepreneurship and change Masters of Arts programs? These are just a small list of the entrepreneurial ideas and decisions that are part of the long history of Pepperdine University. Let me just quickly review how we got to this point, and Dr. Benton mentioned some of that. We had an enthusiastic response to the call for proposals. 150 proposals came. That amounted to 400 pages of documents, and the committee that so agreed to help with this, I'm not sure, realized the weight of the folder they were going to receive. Those folks read those 400 pages, and maybe this would be a good time. The committee is listed on the back of your program. I would ask the committee members to stand at this time, if you would, just quickly. Committee members, stand, please. So the committee working with Dr. Benton came to these 8 phase one finalists. They received a $4,000 grant to plan for this next stage. And they now have submitted a longer proposal that the committee and Dr. Benton has had a chance to look at. The order of the presenters are going to occur as it is listed in your program. We have one exception, is that Dr. Professor Joe Frisch is on sabbatical, so he will appear in video presence tonight. But it will be interesting and fun nonetheless. After the last presenter, Professor Dan Morrison is going to tell us a little bit about how you are going to participate at the conclusion of the presentations. I want to note that all presenters tonight are going to receive a minimum of $500 award. One presenter will receive a $1,500 award, and that's where you're going to come into play to keep you a little bit intrigued about your role. And then at the conclusion of the presentations, the president will confer with the committee, and we will announce tonight at the end those that will receive full funding for their phase two grant proposals. So the bottom line is this. We have eight people that are gonna present tonight, and they spent a big chunk of their holiday preparing a proposal and preparing for this talk. And you're gonna hear from a cross-section of the university community. You're gonna hear from undergraduates, graduate students, faculty, staff. I think that's exciting. And if you appreciate and enjoyed their short wit talk, 7 or 8 minutes, I'd encourage you to give them a good hearty round of applause. So, without further delay, the first ever wit talks.
Pepperdine Executive Preceptorial, presented by Michael Dittmore.
Dialogue. Exchange. Connect. These are the hallmarks of the academy here at Pepperdine University. These are the very things that we aim at, not just while students are in our classrooms, but as they are lifelong learners. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce you and briefly outline the series that we have in mind called the Pepperdine Executive Preceptorial. But before doing so, let me say just a few words of thanks to Bob Clark, who's Executive Director of Alumni Affairs, and also to Matt Ebeling, who's the Director of Alumni Affairs for George Pepperdine College and for Seaver College. We've been in a lot of communication and contact with them. We really appreciate their contributions because they are the ones that help us understand the strategies and logistics and all the details, large and small, in terms of what we're trying to do. And there's no way we could have gotten done what we've done so far or in the future without their help. That's gone really well. They've given us a great deal of encouragement and insight, and we're looking very much forward to working with them again in the future. Here at Pepperdine, as well as throughout academia, one of the great ongoing problems is how to continue to strengthen ties with our alumni and to keep those fresh. And professionals at Alumni Affairs, like Matt and like Bob, do a great deal of work to do that. They are always hard at work at developing different kinds of activities. Some of those are on campus. Some of them are social in character. Some of them happen to deal with service projects of various kinds. Others are more business-oriented. Some of them have to do with online linkages of various kinds. We want to kind of tap into that. They also do things that are off campus in various alumni hubs in places like Seattle or in San Francisco or in Phoenix or in Houston. We want to help them bridge a gap of a different kind because what we are aiming to do is aim for a different kind of niche. For small but intensely committed pockets of alumni and family and friends yearning for what we might call intellectual intimacy, of the very kind that's fostered every day in the classrooms here, that's the very kind of intimacy people can lose as they get into mid-career professional kinds of lives. So we have an equation of Pepperdine family and friends with curiosity, with a desire for dialogue, and to bring to them Pepperdine faculty. Not in a classroom, not for a degree, for a diploma, but in mature, healthy, invigorated dialogue with each other. And that's what we're calling PEP Accept for short. PEP Accept will initially be led by Ted McAllister from the School of Public Policy, and also by Michael Ditmore, yours truly, up here from Seaver College. And we were planning to rely on our years of expertise in leading small group discussions of classic and serious, but not entirely impossible, classic text. What if, we ask, we could take that expertise and that passion and take it out to alumni, faculty, and our family and friends, not on campus, as I said, not for a degree, not for a grade, but simply for mature, invigorating discussion with each other. PEP Accept aims for a different kind of niche, as I mentioned, small but intensely committed pockets of friends. Now, our initial proposal may not look particularly innovative on the face of it. In fact, it's decidedly simple, low-tech, and old-school. So imagine, in the first place, a very pleasant dinner, shared with accomplished and motivated people with common interests and bonds and background, but who may not know each other terribly well. We've all read a book together or some kind of reading. We clear the dishes. Then we move to a place where we can spend 90 minutes of uninterrupted, free, frank, and very invigorating kind of discussion with each other. Then we repeat that 6 times a year. We think the insights and bonding that can come from that kind of experience can be immeasurable in every kind of way. So our beginning template then is fairly simple and may touch on other themes and ideas, for example, beauty, heroism, citizenship, the environment. But we also believe that after a season or two, the reputation of PEP Accept will be such that hubs in various other cities, Pepperdine alumni, will want to host this kind of place on their own. Now here's a sample set of readings we've developed on the theme of love, beginning with Greek drama in Plato, running through Dante, The Imitation of Christ, Shakespeare, and Jane Austen, and concluding with James Joyce's own heartbreaking classic dinner masterpiece, The Dead. But future iterations will differ greatly, depending on the expertise and interests of different faculty and participants and opportunities. For example, we might have an environmental scientist and an environmental law professor who would lead us or lead a team out into the field or into a lab. Or we might have an artist and a psychologist take us into a museum to discuss beauty and artwork. We might have a social scientist and a business professor who might focus on patterns of poverty and migration. A mathematician and a theologian could take on the theme of string theory and the nature of God. A lawyer and historian might take on the Bill of Rights, or an educator and a communication professor could explore cinematic treatments of teachers. But these would not be lectures or refresher courses. The leaders would draw on their expertise and their passion, but no longer assume an imbalance of knowledge or of skill. Instead, we would be co-partners in the frank investigation of knowledge and truth. Now, our current projected itinerary looks something like this. But we would expect committed faculty teams would serve on a 3-year cycle, beginning with the Southern California location, possibly moving to a different host city in the second year, and in the third year, location to be determined. Or they might stay with the same group and choose a new theme, one that wants to continue for another year. Thus, a team might repeat a theme as they go from city to city, or they might hone things by staying with the same group over the course of several years. At this point, we're projecting possibly teams of 3 or 4 each year, rotating at different places in the order. Now, the benefits we expect to accrue to the university are intangible and indirect. First, we think this will enhance the school's academic reputation, especially among those with connections, skills, and influence. Our core groups will start with alumni because of the network of connections already established there. But we would expect to branch out and include present and future Pepperdine friends. These groups could prove to be excellent resources for the school in numerous ways, in influence, in connection, and in other forms of support. In closing, let me just say this, that part of the privilege of being a faculty member is the opportunity to spend so much of one's career wrapped up in exactly these kinds of attention-absorbing discussions of ideas and issues in a very vital kind of way. But we can take that privilege for granted by forgetting that people, when they get into their professional careers, sometimes lose sight of that and don't have the time or a group to be with to make that happen. We see PEP Accept as a service opportunity for Pepperdine faculty that also will strengthen alumni ties, enhance the university's reputation and visibility, and we believe serve as a significant resource in the future. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Designing a Curriculum and Delivery System for Next Generation Executive Students, presented by Terry Tompkins.
And a former student of Dr. Terry Tompkins. It is my absolute pleasure this evening to introduce to you a woman who taught us about the willingness and the courage to change our organization's culture, and most importantly, present us with the education that helped transform ourselves. I present to you Dr. Terry Tompkins.
Put this down. Thank you, Dolores. I see many of my students in the audience tonight. My idea for IMBA Next Generation emerged from many late night and mealtime conversations with you, and I really appreciate it. My Waves of Innovation idea is to create a cutting edge IMBA curriculum and delivery system never seen before. IMBA Next Generation will pay for itself and generate revenue. Even a modest increase of 14 students every other trimester would yield net revenue of over $500,000 a year. The goal of this project is to offer next generation students beyond California the advantages of Pepperdine's national reputation and brand recognition. I propose that we reconfigure the IMBA curriculum into three categories: learning on one's own time, learning in small groups, and learning in intensive face-to-face sessions. The week-long intensives allow us to offer cutting-edge topics at locations related to those emerging issues. For example, we could meet in Washington, D.C., and dialogue with economic policymakers or trade associations to learn how politics and policies affect business. We could then travel to New York and meet meet with venture capitalists to learn about finance and strategy. While there, students can work with a homeless shelter to help residents improve their budgeting skills. Right now, the hottest marketing tool is social media. We can have week-long intensives in the Silicon Valley, meeting with executives from companies like Google, who could demonstrate the properties of big data analysis, a way to understand consumer behavior in digital media. Guest speakers from high-tech companies can explain some of their newest technologies affecting business, which might inspire our entrepreneurs. Students might then develop a social media marketing plan for their own corporations or small business. Intensives offer an additional advantage. We can quickly retool and offer courses on other newly emerging topics. Being nimble and flexible in course redesign is a unique quality of IMBA Next Generation, which gives us an advantage over other IMBA programs in the country. Our two IMBA programs will also benefit from each other. IMBA Next Generation students will join our traditional IMBA students on the international trip to China or India. The intensives in Washington, D.C. and New York can count as a concentration in finance and economics for our traditional IMBA students. The Silicon Valley can count as a concentration in marketing. To teach students all over the globe, we must use technology. Technology is changing education. When new technology is introduced, it can provide a benefit for some, and it can mean disaster for those who fail to recognize the opportunities. For example, Google's search engine made Amazon more than just a bookseller, but it put bookstores out of business. Advances in educational technology have made distant learning a more pleasurable experience. Although I don't think it's better than face-to-face learning, it is getting closer. In my interviews with students taking online courses with award-winning online teachers, I learned that these students actually prefer face-to-face courses. But when necessary, they take online courses because it's more convenient to their schedule or to their commute. The technology has made online courses good enough for students and they're willing to forego their preference for face-to-face education. I also noticed that they take weekly courses and they take online courses, all depending on their schedule and their convenience. Because the market for virtual communication is huge, we can bet that there will be more technological advances that enhance the online experience. If we take advantage of these newly emerging online tools, we can customize learning opportunities for students. Why should an executive be forced to sit in a class to learn about a topic in which he or she is already an expert? What if foundational materials were organized into modules so that the student can demonstrate competency and go deeper into topics of interest or need? Already, top business schools like Harvard, Stanford, Michigan are in the early stages of developing online initiatives. Did you know that Wharton, one of the top business schools in the country, has already put its first year MBA program online for free? They're using MOOCs. MOOCs are open online courses offered for free to the public. What will this mean to Pepperdine and other business schools? This is not an easy task before us. I've led curriculum revisions in the past, so I know the coordination and effort it takes. I've already interviewed dozens of people, exemplary online teachers, business executives, faculty, administrators, and IMBA students. I envision that I'll be conducting a lot more interviews and organizing a number of advisory groups to help create the best ideas and to inform me of emerging topics and technologies. You can't create an innovative program in a vacuum and then present the fully conceived product to faculty and staff and expect their support. It's essential that whoever leads this project constantly consults with those most impacted by the changes. And that way, once it is time to implement IMBA Next Generation, the buy-in and support is there. IMBA Next Generation addresses four of the five waves of innovation goals. One, we improve our ability to use educational technology to enhance teaching and learning. Two, the week-long intensives provide a marvelous opportunity to foster creative curriculum and research ideas. And three, the online schedule allows us to offer IMBA to national and international students, thus increasing enrollments and net revenue. In addition, the intensives involve collaboration with corporations. And five, our traditional IMBA is ranked 23rd in the world by Business Week. Increasing our global market will strengthen Pepperdine's brand and reputation as well. I feel called to serve. I will need the full support of my proposal from the Waves of Innovation Committee and my academic community. This is an innovative approach to executive education. It's not just another distance learning or online program, and it's something that hasn't been done before. This is Pepperdine's opportunity to leap beyond what we know now and prepare for the future. I hope you agree. Thank you.
Center for Gameful Design, presented by Mark Chen and Victoria Stay.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mark.
And I'm Victoria.
And we're here to propose the Pepperdine Center for Gameful Design.
So let's start with a game. We're going to play Buffalo. It's a pretty basic game. There are two cards. One has an adjective and one has a noun. You're going to call out the name of a person, either real or fictional, that you think of associated with the cards. The first person who I hear wins. You don't win anything, but you will have fun. Let's get started.
First lie.
An unconventional superhero.
The Tick.
Superman, I heard that. That's a winner. We'll move on next.
I like
All right. The
Tick better.
White collar thief. All right, I heard a lot. You're all winners. Moving on next. A villainous teacher. Oh, very good. So
nice.
Creative. I love the energy tonight. That's Buffalo.
So this game, Buffalo, that we just played is by Tilt Factor. They're at Dartmouth. It's an NSF-funded project called Transforming Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math, otherwise known as STEM, for Women and Girls, Reworking Stereotypes and Bias.
So in this research, they found that as the players were playing, they actually began to recognize some of the bias that they had associated with socio-demographic characteristics and even began to have dialogue about it.
Right. So well-designed games like Buffalo and these other games, Fold It and Reach for the Sun, are awesome in the sense that they can they have huge potential to affect change and affect learning.
So now that we have you engaged, how do we engage our students?
That's a good question. How do we get our students from looking like this, you know you're out there, to looking like this?
Clearly, playing games engages people.
That's right, and we also just learned that not all games are just simple party games, right? So, in fact, there's a whole line of research around game theory, gameful design, and gamification.
But not just any gamification, Mark.
That's true. Gamification in the vein of some newer scholars who have rethought successfully learning and education. Incorporating gameful and playful mechanics into the actual activity of learning, thereby enhancing learning.
So based on this, we propose the Center for Gameful Design. It's very exciting. So at this center, we want to help faculty to be able to incorporate gameful mechanics into their class curriculum, and for the very motivated faculty to actually be able to design full games for their classes so that your students look like this.
Right. The Pepperdine Center for Gameful Design will be an innovative hub for these playful learning initiatives for post-secondary education. But it will also serve as a common space for designers and researchers to get together and make and study gaming and games for learning.
So now that we've engaged our students, how do we get them to learn?
Well, actually, how do we even know they are learning?
A very good question. And you can probably guess our answer. Games, or more specifically, gameful mechanics that are incorporated into everyday learning practices.
Good point. So for example, we could think of the leveling up mechanic, which is common in a lot of games. It serves to keep players motivated to keep playing, right? But it also actually serves as an assessment tool because we can keep track of player progress towards certain goals. We can keep track of mastery towards a skill.
But let's be real. I know some of you are sitting out there thinking games are a valueless waste of time. So let's spend, 15 seconds to talk about it. We don't have a lot of time.
Yeah, we can do this in 15 seconds. Games are basically systems of rules, all right? You learn these systems by playing the games, by engaging in them, by exploring them, and experimenting with them.
And actually, people are playing games at ever-increasing rates. And we see that games are embedded in everyday culture to the extent that they're starting to shape the future. The whole world is actually made up of systems. We inhabit dynamic and interconnected systems.
Right, and we want to focus particularly on serious games. Serious games are games where systems are modeled after environments, situations, events in reality. And so when players are learning how to behave in these systems, they're also learning how to navigate and affect change in the systems of their everyday lives.
So this is huge. We're saying that engaging in games for learning is transformative.
Right. When you can take the skills that you've learned in a game system and then apply them to the systems of your life, it becomes hugely agentive. You gain a lot of personal agency. This agency can then not only affect your personal lives meaningfully, but collectively we can make the world a better place.
And that's what the center is all about, affecting change in the world through games. And we propose to not only do it through pedagogically innovative initiatives, but also through design and research.
Right, and we want this to be open to basically all of Pepperdine's community.
And we really need all of the community. We want to provide a specific emphasis on those populations that have been traditionally underserved in game design.
Yeah, this is really important. Because games are so transformative, we, as an educational institution in a democratic society, and as Pepperdine University, we have a responsibility and an obligation to make sure we reach as many people as possible because we want to help them affect personal change.
Exactly. When we're talking about game design and STEM in particular, we find that women and minorities have been traditionally underserved. So at our center, we want to make sure that we create an open and inviting game design space that has all diverse populations feeling welcome.
And furthermore, we're going to be concentrating on making games for civics, arts, and humanities. This will complement the national focus on STEM games.
It's a really important relationship. We find that the focus on STEM focuses on saving the world, whereas when we talk about arts and humanities, it gives us reasons for saving the world.
Yeah, and to help Pepperdine gain games literacy, we're going to be hosting game design workshops for everyone, and work with industry partners, such as local ones, such as Sony and Blizzard. And these partnerships will also help us build a sustainable future, which basically means money, right?
So all of these different workshops and special events that we're going to be providing for design purposes will be informed by a specific research agenda. And this research that we're doing is actually going to be filling a current gap in the game design and game literature.
Wait, what gap are you talking about?
Well, so actually, all of the current centers that focus on games and game design research right now primarily focus on K-12 education and the ways in which games and game design affect that education. We, on the other hand, are primarily going to focus on higher education and adult learners.
Yeah, and actually, this feeds really well into our sustainability model, where we're going to be focusing on these center-driven sponsored research. We'll also be coordinating consortia with other game centers.
So at the end of the day, we want to help students learn.
And we want them to be engaged.
We want to change the world.
And the Pepperdine Center for Gameful Design can totally do it.
So let's do it.
Let's build awesome.
Yeah.
College Connection, presented by Suji Oh.
We've heard some amazing presentations so far, and so before I dive into the details of College Connection, I wanted to introduce myself a little. I'm currently a freshman at Seaver College, and I'm also currently a bio major, math minor, so public speaking is not one of my areas of expertise. When I asked what our speech should be like today, I was only given the instruction to format it like a TED Talk. So like the good calm 180 student I am, I watched as many TED Talks as possible. One of the TED Talks that stood out to me the most was presented by Bill Gates. In his talk, he started off by saying, everyone needs a mentor. Professional basketball players, lawyers, singers, and even cooks. We all need people who give us feedback and serve as a source of inspiration. At College Connection, we believe that everyone should have an equal opportunity for education. My roommate Jennifer and I both come from areas in Los Angeles that are notorious for high poverty rates, violence, and gang activity. To protect us from negative peer influences, our family sent us around an hour every day to the Los Angeles Center for Enriched Studies. It was a public high school and middle school located in a more affluent area of Los Angeles, so our education was held to a higher standard. This past summer, I met three students from the Diego Rivera complex, which sounds like a school, and some of its students may argue that it feels like one, but it's just a high school in South LA. I attended an LAUSD school, so I knew that they would not be getting adequate help from their staff when it came to college applications and financial aid. I volunteered my services and told them that they can call me whenever they wanted to. Keep in mind, the kids that I met were the good kids. They were taking all three AP courses that were offered at their school, had 4.0 GPAs, and had amazing personalities and goals. I was a bit shocked when one of the students, Oscar, sent me his rough draft of his personal statement. He grew up under the care of a single mother and had no contact with his father. At the age of 12, he had to raise his sister's two children because her boyfriend ran away and she had to work all day. A year later, he thought he fell in love. And a year after that, he found out that he was going to be a father. To be a good father to his child and to support his girlfriend, he quit school and looked for a job. A few short weeks after, the doctor informed them that she had miscarried. Students in high schools like the Diego Rivera Complex are not dropping out of school because they aren't smart enough, and they don't just wander their neighborhoods aimlessly for fun. These routines are just all they have seen and grown accustomed to. Some of these students don't even consider college as a viable option because they don't have a personal relationship with anyone who's gone. James Comer put it best when he said, "No significant learning occurs without a significant relationship." College has been a realistic goal for me because I've always had access to people who are willing to help. I have siblings, cousins, and college counselors who have gone to private and public colleges and were able to answer my questions. My mentors helped me make decisions on how to choose my university, which scholarships to apply to, and simple things like whether to take the SAT or the ACT. College Connection is a proposal to create a bridge between inner city LA students and college undergraduate students. It will give both Jefferson High and Stever College students an opportunity to meet people of different academic, religious, and socioeconomic backgrounds. This will allow both teams to learn from and inspire each other. Thomas Jefferson High School is one of many public high schools in the South LA area, and they have agreed to be our first partner school once College Connection starts. Due to recent budget cuts, the school has had to lay off their one college counselor, so a lot of these high school seniors don't have anyone else to ask for help. To some people in the audience, Jefferson High might ring a bell. In 2005, Jefferson High was all over the news. There was a fight that broke out between 100 students, and a short week later, there was an even bigger fight, and the police had to get involved. When asked, the students had to admit that the violence was caused because of gang disputes and racial tensions. Since then, Jefferson has gotten better in terms of violence, but their statistics regarding academics have barely changed. Our goal is to have every student in our program enrolled in an institution of higher learning, whether it be a four-year university like Pepperdine or a community college. We would implement our program by providing information for the application requirements like standardized tests, scholarships, personal statements, and more. For an average student to apply to a four-year university, there is a large financial cost. This number might scare some students out of applying before they even look at colleges. With the right financial aid, the price can be taken down to approximately $300. We would be saving each student almost $1,000. College Connection would be continuously reaching out to underprivileged communities in hopes of getting high school students interested in post-secondary education. Our mentors would be a source of knowledge, trust, and motivation for kids who don't have it from anywhere else. No other program like College Connection exists. There are nonprofit organizations that have a similar system, but their mentors are not current undergraduate students who have been in the position of a high schooler within the past 4 years. Most college counselors outside of school charge way too much for information that should be available to all students. As students of Stever College, we are aware of how privileged we are and just how far we've come due to the unwavering support of our parents, religious mentors, and other mentors. As I mentioned before, the main goal for our program would just be to provide students with equal opportunities, or at least give them a more level playing field. College Connection is the start to a local and global change in how city teens can view education. Thank you.
Biodegradable plastics prepared with optimized, environmentally friendly catalysts. Presented by Joe Fritsch.
I'm really excited to talk to you today about biodegradable plastics made with optimized environmentally friendly catalysts. Plastics are ubiquitous in our lives. We rely on them in many particular ways, and many of them are derived from petrochemical resources and degrade in landfills over a long period of time. But what if we could make biodegradable plastics, and what if we could make them in an environmentally friendly way? These two objects, a package for baby spinach and a one-time use conference cup, were made with polylactic acid, a biodegradable plastic. And what if we could make those biodegradable plastics here at Pepperdine? The goals of this project are to develop new environmentally friendly catalysts with environmentally friendly metals like magnesium, zinc, and aluminum. We'd like to utilize these catalysts to make new plastics that will be desirable to consumers. And we'd like to optimize the catalyst performance to make plastics either faster or to make high-value plastics. Along the way, we can imagine a number of broader impacts. Among those is the involvement of students in undergraduate research, where they integrate ideas from across the curriculum, problem solve, and demonstrate tenacity in the laboratory. In addition, we can contribute technological innovations to the fields of inorganic chemistry and polymer science. And along the way, we may make discoveries that are patentable or allow us to pursue an entrepreneurial partnership. So biodegradable plastics have been under development for a while, in part because of your and my interest as consumers in the environmental source and fate of the objects that we use. As a result of this, in 2009, SunChips introduced into the marketplace a biodegradable chip bag. Their first introduction in 2009 was deemed to be too loud by consumers, who quickly rejected it because it was so loud. In 2011, they introduced a new biodegradable chip bag that, after about 1 month in an active compost, it will be fully degraded. The bag was made of polylactic acid, which is used for packaging in biomedical devices, and in a recent article from the American Chemical Society's trade journal, Chemical and Engineering News, NatureWorks, a partnership between Cargill and PTT Global, and Corbion Periac, announced the expansion of their polylactic acid production over the next few years. The catalyst that they use to make their polylactic acid is a tin catalyst, while more recent research focuses on the use of zinc, magnesium, aluminum, and calcium. One of the really special things about polylactic acid is that it comes from a renewable resource, and in this case, from corn. One of the other very special things about polylactic acid is that it's a carbon-neutral polymer. So as we walk around the slide, we start with carbon dioxide and water that are drawn with sunlight drawn into corn through photosynthesis to make the corn that we see. And in the corn, there are a variety of sugars, among them glucose. The corn is harvested, milled, and the sugars inside isolated, and through the process of fermentation and dimerization, converted to this molecule called lactide that we're particularly interested in the lower right-hand corner. Lactide is composed of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen and is formed in a single ring. That lactide molecule can be polymerized. The process of polymerization stitches many small molecules together to make large molecules. So you can imagine stitching one molecule to another, to another, to another, tens, hundreds, or thousands of times to make very, very large molecules. That polymerization process takes the lactide molecule and converts it into polylactic acid, shown here in the lower left-hand corner as clear and colorless beads. Those beads can then be turned into objects like packaging, one-time use cups, or spun into fibers for use in clothing. Those objects then, when their lifetime is expired, can be put into an active compost, and the composting bacteria will degrade the polylactic acid back to carbon dioxide and water, giving us a full carbon neutral cycle. Well, what I thought would be really interesting is to watch one of these polymerizations in progress. And what you see here is one of our second generation catalysts. It's a zinc catalyst, and inside the container you see a stir bar stirring, and you see a bunch of white solid. The white solid is lactide, and we're going to watch it melt over the course of the experiment. In addition, inside of the container is some of our yellow second generation zinc catalyst. That zinc catalyst, its job is to stitch those molecules together and enable a reaction to occur that wouldn't otherwise. At first, the lactide has the viscosity of about water, but as those molecules are stitched together more and more, the viscosity of the liquid rises to be that of about molasses. Once the viscosity has risen enough, the stir bar won't be able to stir the liquid any longer, indicating that full polymerization of those small molecules to large ones has occurred. In this case, the experiment was conducted at 100 degrees Celsius and was completed in under 2 minutes. I've had the benefit of working with a number of excellent students in the research lab, and they've presented their work on 14 occasions at professional conferences, and we've published 3 papers together. One of the things, though, that's special about these students is that they're excellent scientists and have demonstrated their ability to overcome an unanticipated challenge. And each of them could tell you a story about the tenacity that was required to overcome some unanticipated challenge in the laboratory. Well, what can we do with these technological innovations that we've developed in the laboratory? We can do a number of things with them. We can make contributions to the field of inorganic chemistry and polymer science. We can disseminate those results through presentations and publications, and seek external funding from the National Science Foundation or the Dreyfus Foundation. In addition, this proposal offers entrepreneurial opportunities where we could take discoveries from the laboratory and seek patents or develop a partnership with an existing company. And I think the American Chemical Society's Entrepreneurial Resources Center will be very valuable as they have particular expertise in taking chemistry discoveries to the marketplace. Well, along the way, we've built a wonderful team to be able to complete these studies, and future ones will rely on this team as well. And that has included collaborators inside of Pepperdine and outside of Pepperdine to study these complex problems. The work wouldn't be possible without chemistry research students or the support of a variety of different institutions inside Pepperdine and outside, and the support of laboratory staff here at Pepperdine University. Is making biodegradable plastic possible? Yes, and I think we'll be able to do it. Thank you.
The Eden Project, presented by Rhiannon Ballard.
Well, good evening. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. I'm here tonight to talk about the very alarming fact that 3/4 of our undergraduate students have no knowledge about the university's sustainability program. But the good news is the Eden Project provides the solution. But in order for you to understand how the Eden Project accomplishes this, you need to understand a little bit about Pepperdine's sustainability story. So in order for you to do that, let's go back to the 1970s. And thanks to our gracious president and first lady of Pepperdine, they're helping us set the stage for what the 1970s were like. When Pepperdine first moved to the beautiful oceanside community of Malibu, killer fashions, beaches, palm trees, and a laid-back lifestyle were plentiful, but a central sewage system was not. So Pepperdine implemented a wastewater treatment program and also ended up reusing all of our resulting recycled water in our irrigation system. That program continues today, which is why our sustainability program dates back to when the Malibu campus first opened in 1972. Since that time, we've continued and even expanded our initiatives to include everything from energy conservation to sustainability curriculum at all 5 schools. And this has even garnered us inclusion within the Princeton Review's Guide to Green Colleges for the past 3 years running. So what then explains this disconnect between what we're doing on the one hand and what our students are perceiving on the other hand. Well, our recycling program provides some great insight into that, because this program goes largely unnoticed by our students, and it's because of the fact that they have no active role in it. And it's this lack of student engagement that results in the invisibility of our program. And so then the question becomes, okay, so what's the big deal about that? Well, we now know that 7 out of 10 college students consider a sustainability program before applying to that school. But far more important than any sort of recruiting implications is the fact that as a values-based institution, we have a moral obligation to educate our students about Earth's limited resources, about overconsumption, and about their impact on the world around them. So we pulled together an amazing stakeholder committee of students, faculty, and staff to come up with a proposal to respond to this very issue of this lack of student engagement. And what resulted was the Eden Project, which was named by Dr. Stephen Davis. And the goal behind the project is ultimately to bring sustainability home to our students. Because we know that the greatest learning outcomes occur when we combine a sustainable built environment with an educational community. This is where students will adopt lifelong lifestyle changes. So then, of course, the question becomes, okay, so what is this project that's going to allow us to do this? Well, essentially what we're doing is we're taking an existing standard freshman residence hall and transforming it into a masterpiece of sustainable living, including state-of-the-art building retrofits, as well as a comprehensive educational campaign. And this is going to allow us to educate our students both by example and through peer-to-peer modeling. And our committee found it really important to ensure that we allow students to put their own imprint on this environment. And so it's a canvas and it's a framework within which we want students to design their own living and learning experience. And to that end, we're also going to bring in specially trained RAs, SLAs, as well as eco reps, who are going to be student sustainability ambassadors, who help us to not only implement this program, but also to lead, manage, and evolve it in direct response to their fellow students' needs. So, what are the features of this project, which, by the way, we think is going to be the most desirable place to live on campus once it's implemented? Well, first, this is going to be the first place on campus where you're going to be able to see solar panels on the roof. And beyond generation, we're also going to be conserving energy, as occupancy sensors will be shutting down the highly efficient LED lights when students leave the room. In the restrooms, fixtures will save water, and in the lobby, a water filling station will allow students to recycle that disposable, single-use plastic water bottle for the very last time. And because we want our students to be comfortable and breathe clean air, we're going to be using zero VOC materials. We're going to be piloting an exclusively green cleaning maintenance program. We're going to install ceiling fans to get the air moving and flowing. And we're going to be using plants indoors, as well as functional landscaping outdoors. Signs are going to remind students, power down those electronics. And timers in the shower are going to tell students just how long they've been in there. But we're also going to create a cohesive sense of community through hall-wide events. Students are going to volunteer together regularly at charities that are dedicated to environmental and social justice issues. They're going to have a plot in the organic garden, and they're going to go on trips, including to see our recycling and our wastewater program, as well as on Dr. Chris Duran's social justice tour of downtown Los Angeles. But perhaps the most exciting aspect of the Eden Project are going to be the competitions, as we are going to put the residents of the Eden House in direct competition with other residence halls to see who can conserve the most. So during these month-long conservation competitions, we're going to have dashboards in the lobby. Students are going to be able to go there and see in real time just how much they've been consuming relative to other residence halls. They'll be able to tailor their actions and curtail their energy or their water consumption. And ultimately, we hope that they're going to learn how small changes to daily routines can have a huge impact. And of course, we hope that this will change their daily routines beyond these conservation competitions. And of course, what competition wouldn't be appropriate without having awards? So we're going to have fabulous prizes that are going to be awarded by our stakeholder committee, not to mention, of course, the illustrious bragging rights that will go over winning against their peers. But of course, then we have to wonder, as an example of sustainable living, can we really call it sustainable if it can't financially fund itself. And so we've designed that directly into the Eden project as well, as we're going to take all of the savings that are generated from these retrofits, as well as these great conservation efforts, and we're going to put them directly back into the program. It'll not only continue the Eden project, but it'll allow us to expand it and include additional residence halls. Beyond that, we anticipate new streams of revenue in the form of students who see this and want to come and be a part of it, and donors who are interested in environmental and social issues and see this as direct physical evidence that Pepperdine is the perfect place to align with their values. But beyond those financial benefits, we also are going to take all of the information that results that we're going to garner from students during surveys before and after the project. And we're going to inform all of our future residential projects so that they will become hallmarks of sustainable living. So that, in a nutshell, is the Eden Project. But the question remains, how does this change our story? Well, our history remains the same, of course, fabulous fashion and all. But now, instead of having students operating in isolation, they're going to be directly integrated into our program. We anticipate that this will create a ripple effect where these student residents are going to inspire other students, and they're going to inspire other students. And ultimately, this will create a veritable wave of dedicated student advocates who are going to push us to do more, to do it better, and ultimately to make sustainability far more than just something we do, and instead to make it truly a part of who we are as an institution. I suspect that this is just the type of impact that George Pepperdine had in mind when he envisioned an institution that would transform students' lives so that they, in turn, would impact culture and ultimately the world at large. With that, and for your consideration, I give you the Eden Project. Thank you.
The Doctorate in Global Leadership, presented by June Schmieder Ramirez.
So, good evening, members of the Pepperdine community and guests. It is my pleasure tonight to introduce to you the Pepperdine University PhD in Global Leadership. And I'd like to thank, first of all the people that provided assistance on this idea, including Spencer Hardman, Rami Rizkala, Chris Nahara, and I need to kind of give a shout out and ask, who's some of the OL faculty here? Raise your hand, don't be afraid, okay? Dr. Jack McManus, Mr. Tobin, Judge Tobin, Dr. Santos, anyone else here who's a faculty? Okay. Dr. Paul Sparks. Can I have an idea of the OL students here? Could you kind of shout out? Yeah! Okay. Okay, and you drove 2 hours here and you went through a fire. That's good. I like that. So let me talk a little bit about how this idea came about. For the last 5 years, I've interviewed organizational leadership students, and it's a great program. It's increasing in enrollment, and they asked me one question. They said, you know, June, we have an EDD program. It's great, but why don't we have a PhD program? And you know what? I kept saying, you know, why not? Why don't we have a PhD program? So tonight, what I'd like to do is to present to you a PhD program, which I think would encompass global leadership and would make us a world-class global university. So let's start. First of all, we have to answer one question, and that's the most important question, and one which I hope that I will be communicating. What is the problem we are trying to solve? And how does this idea solve the problem? We need to, first of all, be ahead of the wave in producing the new global leader, and we cannot fall behind others who are moving forward. That's the first issue. Two, you know, there's a lot of business books out there, and we need to kind of break through that clutter. You know, you're told to lean in, lean out. What are 10 habits of highly effective? What are 20 habits? You really need to cut through that clutter, right? Okay. You're Wendy there. Three, we need to go past the traditional business leadership programs. They are gaining an enrollment now throughout the United States, but we have to be different. And this is the, one of the most important reasons is there has become a space that has become available that needs to be filled with a global leadership program. We need to have a new, rigorous global leader, and this program will satisfy that need. So what is the answer? This is the vision. We need to have a rigorous program which fills a unique space and links the resources of Pepperdine University, much as you have diamonds throughout the world, and they're linked into a necklace, into a total circle. So what the program is not, it's really not one person's idea of what a doctoral program should be. This is really an interdisciplinary program that involves all five schools. And I don't know why I put that slide in there. I'm just into Captain Kirk. I don't know. Sometimes, you know, it just... So, someone said to me, it's not possible to link the faculty of all five schools in a common effort. And it really, you know, I'm not sure you can link everything throughout the world, Switzerland, Germany, you know. What is this thing about smart rooms? How can that link things together? And it's not possible to create a new program that would be a magnet for the best and the brightest minds. So I said, what did I say?
Why not?
Yay! Very good. Okay, why not? You bet. So... And how about why? Why should Pepperdine offer this degree? Well, students would benefit. They would be able to lead in the highest level universities and industries throughout the world. There would be a linkage and interconnectedness throughout all the sites that Pepperdine has in the world. The global leadership PhD would enhance the brand and ranking throughout the world. We need to produce original research. We are doing that now with our practical EDD, but it needs to be done more. So who's involved? 15 to 18 students, the first cohorts. We are planning to have potential candidates for the program. Actually, we already have inquiries about a possible program from alumni and others. Where would it be located? It would be located at our beautiful Washington, D.C. Center campus. And what would it look like? You would have a dissertation of original research. You might do concentration in social justice, faith, and ethical decision making. You pick your concentration, but there would be a core. And this is the basic model. You would have a core research, leadership, and ethics. You would, might have a concentration of global change, nonprofit, faith, ethics, and spirituality. So that would be the basic model. What I'm going to do now is to kind of give you a feeling of what it would feel like to be in this program. So I'm going to do something a little bit different. This is a quote that I like also. So bear with me as we kind of get a feeling of what this would look like.
From the day we arrive on the planet, and step into the sun. More to see than can ever be seen, more to do than can ever be done. There's far too much to take in, more to find than can ever be found. But the sun rolling high in the sapphire sky keeps great and small on the endless round. It's the sun.
Yeah.
Shipboard Education, presented by Charles Hall.
Thank you. Thank you. This proposal has to do with a ship. And as you have already heard tonight, all proposals in some way are connected with a problem. We have two problems. First of all, we have limited exposure to developing countries in our offerings of our international programs. And secondly, as good a job as we do with our programs, our students still have limited knowledge of countries and continents. Let me give you some examples. And these are not staged, by the way.
What country will you find the Brandenburg Gate?
Brandenburg Gate. London? No, not London. England.
Where would you find the Gaza Strip?
Jerusalem.
All right, which city is the capital of France? Is it London, Rome, or Berlin?
It's Berlin, right? No, London.
Name three of the countries that make up Scandinavia.
Romania.
Iceland.
Iceland.
That one that starts with an L. That's a really weird,
Lithuania.
Lithuania.
Lithuania. What country would you find the Panama Canal?
I'm really bad with geography.
This is a tough one.
Guatemala.
Guatemala. The Panama Canal is in Guatemala. Is that your final answer?
I feel like saying Panama, but that's probably not a country. I don't know, I'm confused.
Unfortunately, those were not staged, and it's quite pathetic, if you would agree with me. So that's the first problem. The second problem is we have a limited reach. Notice the green areas here. This is where we presently have international programs, and pretty much where students travel around those particular countries. And we do a pretty good job, but notice the yellow areas. Those are areas that we are not exposing our students to. Our current model is a good one. We choose a particular country. We will either buy or lease a facility, and students will live together in these facilities where they go to class together, a living learning community, etc. And that's a good model for certain countries, but probably not a good model for developing countries. That's why I want to introduce you to the idea of shipboard educational voyages. Did you know this? That 75% of the world's population lives within 100 miles of a port city. And most of those port cities are in developing countries. I want you to use your imagination tonight. Imagine that we could offer, say, something like a West African voyage, where students are going to explore the coast of West Africa. We lease a ship, we go to various ports, Sierra Leone, Ghana, all the way down to Cameroon. They're on board a ship, and they're taking courses together. Maybe they're getting their GE credits. They're living in community. So much like they do in our regular international programs, they are living together, taking classes together, they're doing co-curricular activities as well as extracurricular activities. And then imagine that we have a theme course. So in addition to the courses they're taking for GE credit, imagine they do a theme course. In this case, what about all of them studying the religions of Africa? And then they pull into these ports and go on 3 to 5 day excursions where their activities, experiential learning, are connected to their academics, or they could be involved in a service learning project. Imagine on one of these legs, we invite a visiting scholar to teach them about the country or the port that they're about to enter. Imagine having Bishop Desmond Tutu join us from Ghana all the way down to Cape Town, and as he travels with us, he lectures on the issues of the history of South African apartheid, and maybe even talk to us about the life of Nelson Mandela. And then imagine that we enter the port in Cape Town and our students join South African students for a listening summit where they study, learn together and about the topic of leadership and social justice. And then imagine all the possibilities. We could have programs that focus on Christian service. We could have a voyage in which it's focused on research, particularly between faculty and students. Imagine that we could use the ship for alumni events or regents, and specifically look at programs that are tied to different majors. So business majors doing a trip in a developing country where they go into ports and they actually experience NGOs or nonprofit organizations. Or imagine the natural science division that would sponsor a trip related to marine biology and maybe conservation in our oceans. Now, we all were given some money to start exploring this. We were given about $4,000. And what we did with our money is we did a one-day retreat with an organization called Global Oceanic. They're a startup foundation that had the same idea we did, some kind of Christian version of a semester at sea. And we learned a lot about the complexities of shipboard education. But what we came up with from that retreat was we could do it ourselves. Now, how can we do that? As in all experiments with new international programs, we start with short-term, small scale. So imagine for a moment, summer of 2015, we do some kind of expedition of biblical sites. What about a ship that traces the journeys, missionary journeys of St. Paul? Or imagine an Arabian Sea voyage in which we're going to study business organizations all the way down from Mumbai even to Sri Lanka. And now I want you to really put on your imagination and dream big with me. What about a whole semester, Pepperdine semester at sea, much like what the University of Virginia does with their semester at sea, a Pepperdine version of semester at sea with a Christian mission. Imagine that we start out in San Diego when we go to various cities around the world, an almost global 15 weeks where students go to these various cities. They're learning together, studying together, they have lectures on different legs, and they end up with in Southampton, London. Imagine that. And let me end with this, a big imagination. What if we had our own ship? And we called it the Wave. I think this is possible, and I hope you do too. Thank you.
Well, I predicted that would be fun, and I think it was fun. The break was a little longer than we anticipated because the decisions were a little harder than the committee and the president anticipated. And so here are the decisions. Is our chief financial officer sitting down? Yeah. They were so good, some changes were made. Well, two proposals, they were all good, and the committee felt that way, certainly the president and I felt that way. Two proposals are not a no, but they are a not now, and that we would like to explore them more. Those two are shipboard education and the global leadership PhD. So at this time, those two, we would like to learn more about them in the future. Well, let's give those two proposals a round. Oh, and I should note that the People's Choice Award, where you folks got to weigh in, that went to the presentation of the Center for Gameful Design. So they will receive a $1,500 award. Now for the awards for the projects. The Eden Project has been awarded $150,000. Rhiannon, please come forward.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
The Center for Gameful Design has been awarded $82,800. The Pepperdine Executive Preceptorial has been awarded $26,400. Professor Joe Frisch and Biodegradable Plastics has been awarded $69,300. Kimberly, one of Professor Fish's undergraduates, accepting his award. I must admit, I was pulling for this one. College Connections will be awarded $35,000. And Professor Tompkins, Designing a Curriculum and Delivery System for Next Generation Executive Students, has been awarded $83,000. Folks, I'm fired up. That was good. So, like all good things, there's a new beginning. The next round of proposals, please be thinking of your ideas so that you can be on this stage and receive one of these awards as well. The next round of proposals, September 15, 2014. We look forward to it. We hope you write a lot of proposals and you can match the creativity and the entrepreneurial spirit that we saw this very first year. Thanks so much for participating and thanks for being here tonight. Thank you.